Hi, and welcome to my talk, Green Software Engineering, The Curse of Methodology. This is presented by me, Abram Hindle. I'm in computing science at the University of Alberta, Canada. My email address is hindle1@ualberta.ca. And I'm always looking for energy-interested PhD students who are interested in doing research on software energy consumption. Today, I'm going to be talking about the future of software energy consumption. So, fundamentally, the electrical work that we make a computer do is pretty well equivalent to the electrical work we make a light bulb do. We rate light bulbs by the power that they use in order to produce light. Their task is relatively simple. But the neat thing about software is that software commands hardware, and thus the commands of software can now be physically measured with software energy consumption. We can measure what a system actually does and its energy consumption as well as its power over time to execute a software task. This is really neat because we bring software execution and computation into the fold of physics, whereby we can use the same terminology of effort and work to describe how much effort or work it takes for software and hardware to work together to achieve a task. This also means that fundamentally we can measure the cost of software, and we can measure it because we know how much electricity costs. So in North America, most electricity comes from coal-fired power plants, which means that any electrical use from these plants has a carbon footprint. And that carbon footprint implies that that it will have an effect on climate change due to its emissions of CO2. Now, at the same time, this also means that we can measure energy consumption and price it. So if we get electricity from that coal power plant, it goes to our energy meter, which reports back to the utility how much we're using. It will measure the use, the energy consumption of our computer, and thus we will know how much things cost. For instance, if I did deep learning on my computer at home, which has an NVIDIA card in it, it would be up to 240 watts. After about 4 hours, I'd owe the energy company about 12 cents for that 1 kilowatt hour of energy. So when we're measuring software energy and we're talking about it, we have two main contexts of task. We have continuous work, that's things that provide a service, and then we also have energy consumed to fulfill a task. An example of continuous work would be something like serving a web page, would be like entertaining a user playing video games. So every hour of entertainment would cost you so much in energy, just like how every hour you spend reading a book with the light on costs you so much in energy. Well, this also translates into tasks. The difference between a service and task is that these do continuous work while you have them turned on, whereas a task has a start and an end, and you have less of a say when it actually ends. An example of a task is compressing a file. Another example of a task is moving files around or answering database queries. Database queries don't always need to be answered all the time, or they're not asked all the time. When we measure work, a continuous service, we measure it in watts, and watts are basically power. When we measure a task, we measure it in the energy consumed, which is joules. To convert the current power to energy consumed, we basically integrate over time. So 1 watt second is equal to 1 joule, and 1 watt hour is equal to 3,600 joules, right? And a kilowatt hour is 1,000 times that. So your energy company will probably bill you in kilowatt hours, but what's going to happen is that we can convert those into joules. So generally when you talk about energy consumed, you should talk in joules. When you talk about power, how much energy you need at a certain time to operate, you should talk in watts. So how could we use software energy consumption? Well, we could use it to rank apps. You could imagine two different apps that do pretty well the same thing. They do email. One does it really boringly, the other one does it really excitingly. The exciting one has neat animations and all that. The super boring email, its main feature is its efficiency and its kind of lack of flash. as a consumer, you might want to know which one's more energy efficient, because you might be in energy constrained environments where you might be into more efficiency rather than more features, or you might be in an environment where energy efficiency doesn't matter so much to you. You're maybe charging your phone right now, so usability might be more important. Researchers have looked into this, such as Jang et al. And Jeberand et al. So this is quite interesting. If we look at Laurie Pollock's work with and Sagan's and Klaus's work with seeds, or we look at that kind of work, we can see that it's not only apps that can be ranked, but it's also libraries that can be ranked. You could imagine that we could rank open source libraries by their energy consumption. Currently, this hasn't really caught on, but it's always a possibility whereby we could determine the difference in software between how efficient it was at a certain task. This is a little bit different than heating up your roast in the oven or turning on a light bulb, because, well, turning on a light bulb produces light. There's nothing else you'd really do with a light bulb, but an email app at least does three things. You read emails, you send them, and you receive them. So essentially, we'd have to worry about efficiency per operation. But I think beyond just ranking apps, we should really consider ranking libraries themselves. In order to do so, usually we have to measure a system. So we propose the Green Miner, and that was described in 2014, but we used something like Green Miner to mine software engineering ever since like 2012. So the Green Miner is an energy measurement framework that continuously tests software and measures its energy use. Others, such as Banerjee et al., have done similar systems. Lee et al. Have a system that does megahertz sampling and can give you source line resolution using a certain droid product. Gupta et al., they did energy measurement quite quickly, but what they did is they benchmarked libraries to basically get energy traces of those libraries, and that basically allowed you to get per software component level measurement. Now, when you do this measurement, you should be really aware of what you're measuring. The Green Miner does whole system measurement; the entire phone is under measurement. Whereas if you use PowerTop from Intel or Intel's RAPL or ACPI, you'd be using component level measurement. You'd be paying attention to CPU and memory use, and you might miss out on, say, peripherals, I/O, and other kinds of hardware. Now, measurement is difficult because it requires you to do a lot of it and repeat it such that you get a stable result. And this is difficult for developers, so many have tried to generate models of software energy consumption that either produce estimates in terms of joules, in terms of power, in terms of which code affects it, in terms of which methods or lines of code affect it, or what the difference in versions is. The problem with these models is typically when we propose such a model, it's stuck to, say, one operating system, one CPU, one screen type, and one set of peripherals. So it's kind of difficult to actually come up with a big general model. And even if we have a nice general model, it's still hard to explain how the parameters change when we move from, say, Android to Linux, or Linux to OS X, or OS X to Windows. Or when we move from x86 to ARM, or bigger screens, or different peripherals. So at the moment, we've got a lot of work, like Gupta et al., Linares Vasquez, Gui, Lee, Howe, Sayan, Pelotonin, Agarwal, Pathak, lots and lots of people, and that's just like a tiny list. There's lots. Lots of people are generating models, and it's currently being done, but the models are always, you know, pinned to certain things such that it's not, one model is not necessarily applicable to one task, and not everyone's models are able to run on everyone's tasks or purposes. So we've got all these models, and they don't always work together, and they don't always work on the same platform. So people are concerned about how do we generalize these models. So like Jang et al. Suggested linear models to correct models between similar devices. So there's some research in this. But nonetheless, so we got measurement and we got modeling and generalization. The way this stuff is used is people care about like the effect of ads on things, like we at all. People care about the effect of OLED screens, like we and Lee. And people care about refactoring, like San et al. All these kinds of things people care about, and they're being dealt with energy models. But to build these energy models, we still needed measurement. All right. So that's kind of where we're at. We've got all these questions that we're starting to answer. We've got models of energy. The models are kind of tuned to one platform each. We've got some ideas of what uses more, what uses less. A lot of it's platform dependent. So what do we really face? We face a lot of challenges. And a lot of challenges simply come from the community itself. And the reason why these are community relevant challenges is because we need basically shared data, and we need shared tools. And once we have those shared data and shared tools, we need to make shared benchmarks such that we know if for a certain task there's improvement. And then, even if we do that, we still have to come to some agreements on what measurement methodology is and modeling methodology is. As well as, we have community aspects like how do we communicate to each other, how do we see each other's work, things like that. And this all kind of comes from the research community being spread across a lot of disciplines. So, one of the challenges was lack of data. So, the big thing is that there's no shared FLOSS energy data. No free Libre open source software energy data is available right now. All we have is discussions on Stack Overflow and some discussions and commits. We have very limited performance data in general, and we have far less energy data available. There are very few shared research data repositories, and there's a good reason for this. It's not just everyone's fault. It's the fact that it's economically infeasible and it's very costly. You need lots of data. You need to you need lots of tests to generate the data, and the tests need to be run multiple times, right? So that's a big problem. And then basically one test that's run on one application is not necessarily meaningful to another application, so there's not always a guarantee that you can share information between applications. There's heterogeneous data, like do we measure per megahertz, do we have system calls, do we have program traces, what do we got? And then there's no shared format. So if there's no shared format and it's heterogeneous data, it's hard to make a shared research data repository that we can all contribute to, especially if we have to run multiple test cases, which means we have this multi-dimensional data. So it's costly and it's complicated. So that's one big reason we don't have the data. And open source tends not to have repositories that stores this data other than maybe stack trace repositories. CPU is not enough. And I say this in the context of software energy modeling. A lot of people will try to model software energy or measure it just at the CPU level. Now, this isn't enough because I/O is computation. So anytime we use a peripheral to do I/O, we have to actually measure those peripherals to get the energy use. Hard drives use a lot of energy, Wi-Fi cards use a lot of energy, and GPUs, they use tons of energy. If we don't model them, and they're not in our equations, we miss out on a ton of energy that's being used. So that's a big issue. It's kind of an issue of like holistic measurement. Do we measure the individual, or do we measure the individual plus the whole? You could imagine in the case of, say, a cell phone app that had cloud support, that we could just measure the cell phone app, but really, maybe we should also measure the cloud support that supports the cell phone app to get some idea of the sustainability of the entire system. So anyways, CPU and memory aren't enough. REPL in Intel is really great, but it's still not enough. It misses out on I/O. And for business software, this is very relevant because a lot of business software is database oriented and storage oriented. So if we don't address that, we're kind of missing out on entire areas of software development. A problem when you're measuring the software and when you're posing tests to actually measure the software is the non-determinism. Depending where you are, you can have a find different effects in terms of electromagnetic radiation. Did people turn the microwave on? You know, there's also issues in terms of the current state of the system. How fragmented is memory? How fragmented is the file system? Is it reliable? Is the file system repeatable? Usually it's not. And even if you use like a virtual machine, it's still stored on a disk somewhere, and it could get fragmented and defragmented, and you wouldn't really know. So your tests would be kind of different every time. The location where you're at really matters, how much traffic's going on, is there network congestion, what's nearby, are there event producers nearby, things like that. And then finally, your CPU state matters. If it takes a long time to set up a test, you might have been putting the CPU state into a higher frequency state rather than a lower frequency state. So the CPU state really, really matters, because you just don't know unless you check it or you set it what the CPU state is, and it can make two tests look very different even though they do the same thing. So those were challenges that one has to be aware of and one has to look into. But one big challenge in terms of research is that there's multiple interests, like smart city energy, hardware energy, sustainability, software energy, and that these interests are not always shared by all communities, and that there's many subsets of communities that are interested in these things. So if you publish at, say, some of these venues, it might be invisible to people at these venues. And these software engineering venues, well, they're interested in software energy, but they don't necessarily have reviewers who have expertise to review in software energy. Then there's RE, who's getting really interested in requirements about sustainability in software energy, and they don't necessarily have people with the expertise to deal with these things. Maybe these communities have more people that have the expertise, but they're not necessarily the same people. So it's fragmented, it's spread out, there's diverse interests, you know, and there's kind of a lack of visibility. So it's easy to get lost, it's easy to not see other people's work. And there's a kind of incoherence to it all. Now, it's not really anyone's fault. Nothing's really been put together. There's been no clear initiatives. It's just an issue of a community that kind of needs to self-organize a little bit more. So I talked about some major challenges, and I mentioned maybe some pitfalls there. So now I'm going to discuss pitfalls that exist, but these are pitfalls that can become papers. Every single pitfall I list here is basically a paper, or maybe a PhD thesis. So one question is if we make a software energy test, does the test coverage really matter? So the 60% coverage test, do they test software energy better than 10% coverage test? They might not. If most of the energy gets consumed in tight loops in that 10%, the 60% could be irrelevant exception handling that's not representative. So your coverage might matter, but it might not. Where you get your measurements from or your estimates of software energy might not be very reliable. If you use ACPI, lots of the measurements come from batteries. The batteries each have their own measurement chips inside. They might have cheaped out on them, they might be miscalibrated, you don't know. When you're testing multiple versions of the same software, there's a lot of versions to test. How many times you have to test each version isn't necessary. If we need to check to see if the software changes fundamentally in the past or the future, how much testing do we actually have to do? Then, if we, say, care about cloud computing, so the context of data centers and things like that, isolation of tests really matters. This also matters on the phone. Do we make the phone really quiet and disable all the Android services, like the Google services? Or do we leave them all running such that it's a more realistic environment? So it's basically like, can you isolate, or can you still operate in a noisy environment? And both have advantages and disadvantages. So these are effectively papers that one can write and investigate the issues and discuss the issues, and they're currently available. So it's kind of like future work, but it's stuff that you can do right now, stuff that a PhD student could execute. Another question that we don't have good answers to is, what are platform differences? Can I convert models from Linux to Android? Can I convert Android models to Windows? Can I convert Linux models to Mac? Can I convert Mac models to Windows? What are the platform differences? What do we know about it? Then there's issues about state. Can we get around statefulness, such as fragmentation and things like that, by repeated tests? What kinds of state will repeated tests not allow us to address? What kinds of state does repeated tests let us ignore? There's the issue of how much Wi-Fi affects things, like how close you are to the router, energy consumption there. There's also the issue of temperature. Temperature is fundamentally related to energy consumption, because you've got hardware, and the hardware's resistance will increase as the temperature increases. Furthermore, with computers, they typically have cooling systems if they're in the servers. Servers have cooling systems, and that costs more energy to cool. And then data centers typically have air conditioning and other kinds of cooling, whereby if the service cooling isn't enough, they have to air condition the whole place. So there's like a 30% energy overhead in cooling. It's crazy. And what effect does that have? If you run on a hot system, is it a legitimate test? Should we be testing Android phones at body temperature rather than, you know, room temperature? Then finally, when we run these tests, what's the effect of instrumentation versus actually doing it yourself? Like, if I record my mouse clicks and I play it back with a machine, which one uses more energy? Do we get more interrupts from me clicking or running the instrumentation here? Does that harm it more? Does this cost more than this? And then, how much does fragmentation matter? No one's actually investigated this. If the disk is fragmented, or how do tests change over time with fragmentation? Do we get a degradation? Do we get cleanups? Do we get inconsistent history? It's not really clear. So, this is the future of software engineering track, and we have to talk about the future of software energy consumption. The immediate future that I see is that most software energy papers will have better methodology. Every time you compare systems, you will have to do multiple runs each. It'll be a given. There's no way around this. And then, when you're comparing systems, you'll do it in an evolutionarily aware way. And now, this might seem overboard, but really, if you're looking at an existing system and you want to know if you're changing software energy, you're always doing multi-version analysis because you're comparing the current version with the last version, right? So you're always doing the multi-version analysis. So really, software energy is quite important in an evolutionary sense, because you don't really want to change things on the client. You don't want their phone to die. You don't want their data center to crash and burn, quite literally, just because your software changed a lot and it changed the energy consumption requirements. The future will also help programmers, because programmers won't be asked to have the knowledge necessary to actually measure software energy consumption. I hope for a future where developers never really have to deal with it, never have to address it, because they'll be no longer responsible for it, because they'll delegate it to Pluggy in your IDE, kind of like Clippy, which can help you save energy, and it will model energy for you, or you can just ask IDE to do work. Some of this kind of functionality already exists in Visual Studio. Or we'll offshore to testing services. So your developer will just ship a version to the test service. Multiple devices under hardware instrumentation will run the code, or multiple fake devices with full virtualization instrumentation will run it and use their models to estimate the energy consumption of your version, and you won't have to do it yourself. This will be part of continuous integration, hopefully, so you won't even see it. Continuous integration, continuous inspection. So, developers shouldn't have to measure software energy. It takes a lot of expertise. Let's offshore the expertise to testing services, and let's integrate expertise into agents inside of their development environments. Hopefully they'll never have to measure software energy consumption directly again. Current and future research will focus a lot on the cloud. The cloud is a big deal right now. It's platform as a service, software as a service. It's kind of a juggernaut in business, and parts of the cloud are changing. Cloud used to be mostly VM only, but now we're getting platform as a service. Now we're getting containers and services. We're moving away from VMs and we're moving into more lightweight containers, but we don't have to estimate them. So if we're running like a LAMP Docker or a MeanStack Docker, or it's like Nginx, MongoDB, and PHP altogether Docker, we don't know how much energy it will use under certain loads. We don't have estimators for that. And we don't know how well the Dockers work together. There's just a lot of questions. So Patricia Lago's group has done a little bit of research on cloud. Housie Mueller's group has done a little bit of research on cloud. In terms of software energy, there's a lot of stuff that's possible, but it's not always being done in a realistic fashion. Like, some people work on cloud energy research and they do like specint tests, so linear algebra tests, and that's kind of irrelevant to a lot of cloud business use, because a lot of cloud business uses I/O, it's record passing, it's record recording, it's processing transactions. It's not necessarily the same as linear algebra. So there's an issue of realism. So if we're going to estimate loads, how realistic can we be? Lego et al., Becker et al., others have focused a lot on sustainability and requirements. If you used Amazon Web Services, you'll know that you get charged for your I.O., you get charged for at least CPU time, you get charged for memory and CPU at pretty well at the same time. You definitely get charged for your network. You're not being charged for wattage yet, but I bet you the second that they push that cost down to the AWS consumer, you'll definitely notice it, and people will definitely budget for it. What this means is that sustainability and energy use will become basically an important part of requirements and defining what we can afford versus what we got. So we will have to balance the features that we want against our energy envelope, as well as what our developers and our community can do and our hardware. So you're just going to have to balance this. What's really neat is because we can price computation now, it basically brings back the almighty dollar to software engineering. We've now got pretty well like direct monetary costs. And, you know, software engineering exists because we could make any kind of software we want, but we have to solve a problem, and we have to solve it economically. That's engineering. It's solving problems with economic constraints. And quite frankly, your energy use will become a huge economic constraint, especially when data centers and stuff like that, they start pushing down this cost of watts and joules down to the down to the data center consumer, down to the people renting boxes, down to the people using the cloud. So the second you start billing for it, you'll notice it immediately. People will care. Basically, right now, a lot of it's kind of folded in into other costs, but if they break it out, you'll totally notice it. So I think it's really neat, and I think it makes the economics more direct. It's kind of like the mobile app store in terms of direct feedback and economics, but this is direct costs. So that's kind of interesting. The future will include education. Currently, there's a real lack of education. Paying it all, they went out, they hassled a bunch of people and asked them questions, a bunch of developers, and asked them questions about software energy. Developers didn't know a lot. Some knew some, but most weren't really sure about software energy, didn't know. And, you know, who can blame them? There's a real lack of syllabi. There's a lack of curriculum. There's no MOOCs you can take right now. It's kind of a lack of textbooks. Most of the education is kind of sustainability thrust, but there's not a lot of that either. So we basically need to look into sustainability education, look into software energy education. And you know what? People like Pinto et al. And Wilkie et al. Have found that, yeah, people were asking about software energy. People care about it. People want to know about it. So we need to educate people. And we can't just educate current undergrads. We have to have resources available for current programmers, people who are not necessarily going to take new courses, who are not necessarily going to go through formal training again just to address software energy. So education is very important. We currently know that programmers don't have a lot of background in this field, and they need more background. So education is one possible solution. So in conclusion, I talked about how cool software energy is and how it's really neat that we can basically relate the physics measurements of work and effort and relate them to computation, and we can rank our computation like we'd rank, you know, light bulbs at Home Depot. So that's kind of neat. And with this software energy consumption and measurement of software comes a lot of challenges. Basically, the community itself, how do we model things, how do we do big data models and all that methodology. And the software energy consumption is quite interesting because there's two big areas that it's related to. There's mobile computing, where software energy limits your availability, and then there's cloud computing, there's data center computing, there's server computing, whereby you have to pay for the energy, and it's using a lot of energy, and it causes a lot of cooling costs. So there's basically like two sides of the spectrum. One's availability, and one's like monetary cost and equipment cost. It's kind of interesting. And these challenges are related to those contexts. And they're related to the data that's available already, which isn't a lot, the tools that are available, not a lot, the benchmarks that are available, not a lot, the methodology that's shared and available, still not a lot. And when you start addressing some of this stuff and you start measuring this stuff, you quickly find there's a lot of pitfalls. But some of these pitfalls can become immediate papers. Like, you can do the work right now and you'll get a publication out of it. It's pretty neat. whether it's test coverage or reliability or isolation versus not isolated. What this leads to is a future in software energy consumption where people hopefully will have better methodologies than we currently have, where people will be evolutionarily aware and apply multi-version analysis, but they'll have sustainability issues they have to deal with, and they'll know that they have to deal with these sustainability issues because they're educated. Hopefully, they never have to measure software energy consumption again. That kind of knowledge will be offshored to like IDEs and little agents like Pluggy, who tells you you're using too much energy. And hopefully, when we write server-side software, we'll get good estimates of, say, cloud and container use. So in conclusion, a lot of the issues that were brought up are basically because the issues are important, they're related to data centers and mobile, and they're kind of community-related issues because it's about how we can go further. And what we need to do to go further is to actually share data so we can build big data models. We need to share tools so we can compare tools and build new tools on top of them. We need benchmarks to rank how well our tools are operating, how well our big data models are working, and methodology such that we can be consistent about it. And it all kind of comes back down to community, and I hope to see that improve in the future. Really, it's community in the future that will change, and it will basically guide a lot of the issues that I brought up, and it'll solve or address a lot of the pitfalls. Thank you for your time.